So we've learned that a food chain is a simple way to illustrate the flow of matter and energy through an ecosystem. I think we got that covered. But we also know that an ecosystem is a very complex community full of lots of different organisms that interact with each other in lots of different ways. In order to illustrate the complexity of these different connections, a simple food chain just won't cut it. That's where a food web comes in handy. Basically, we can say that a food web is made up of many different intersecting food chains.
Let's start with a food chain we made in our first video. We'll use arrows to show what is eaten by what. First is our producer, periphyton, which is nibbled on by the mosquito larva, which is munched on by the gambusia, which is chowed upon by the great blue heron, which is devoured by the alligator. Simple enough. But then there's the sailfin molly. It eats periphyton too, as well as mosquito larvae. The molly also eats little bits of submerged sawgrass. The great blue heron would scarf down a sailfin molly if it could. So would an anhinga. So would a raccoon. The raccoon would also enjoy a baby anhinga, as would the alligator. The alligator wouldn't pass up a raccoon either. But a white-tailed deer munching on sawgrass would be an ideal meal for the gator, or a rare Florida panther.
We're now starting to see how complex and interconnected everything is, but there are still thousands of plants and animals that we haven't included in our, let's face it, very simple Everglades food web.
Some of these animals can be quite picky, like the limpkin, which feeds almost entirely on freshwater apple snails. This, of course, makes the limpkin a secondary consumer, or a carnivore, while the apple snail is a primary consumer, or herbivore, because it browses on aquatic plants. The purple galinol, on the other hand, is less picky. It might pick apart the fruit of a spatterdock plant to feast on its seeds, or score a bit of protein from a baby red-bellied turtle. Since the purple galinol eats both animals and plants, we call it an omnivore.
So that's just one little part of the Everglades food web. The food web helps us to understand that in an ecosystem, all plants and animals rely on each other some way for survival. It's an intricate and important network of life, kind of like a finely woven tapestry. So what would happen if you pulled out one of those threads? If you remove something from the web, say an apple snail or a sailfin molly? Or what would happen if you dropped in something that didn't belong there? An invasive species like a Burmese python or an Argentine black and white tegu? I'll let you chew on that for a little bit.